بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Our topic is about alignment and leveling. Comprehensive orthodontic treatment is divided into three stages: alignment and leveling, correction of molar relationship and space closure, and finally finishing. Outlines of our lecture. First, goals of first stage of treatment. Second, alignment. Then we will talk about crossbite correction, impacted or unerupted teeth, diastema closure. Goals of first stage of treatment. Orthodontic treatment without specific goals can be an excellent illustration of the old age. If you don't know when you are going, it doesn't matter which route you take. The best alignment procedure will result in incisors that are far too protrusive if the extraction necessary to prevent protrusion were not part of the plan. Treatment of adult class 3 patient having anterior crossbite by intrusion of posterior teeth will increase the severity of class 3. While treating an adult class 2 patient having the same problem by the same way will improve the case. So the treatment for any patient should be undertaken only after a thorough analysis of patient's problem, the preparation of a treatment plan, and development of a sequence of orthodontic treatment steps to produce the desired result. The goals of leveling and alignment stage are correction of malaligned teeth, correction of transverse discrepancy, correction of vertical discrepancy, and finally correction of impacted teeth. Alignment. Principles in the choice of alignment arches. In nearly every patient with malaligned teeth, the root abscess are closer to the normal position than the crowns. Because malalignment always develops as the eruption paths of the teeth are deflected except in transposition cases. To bring teeth into alignment, a combination of labiolingual and mesiodistal tapping guided by arch wire is needed, but root movement usually is not. Wire used for alignment are super elastic knot tie wire, thermal activated knot tie wire, multi-strand knot tie wire, multi-strand of steel wire. Properties of alignment arch wire: excellent strength, excellent springiness, long action, a long range of action, with the wire delivering about 50 gram, the optimum force for tipping. The variable in selecting appropriate arch wire for alignment are the arch wire material, nitinol versus stainless steel, and its size, diameter or cross section, bracket slot size, and interbracket distance. The arch wire should provide light continuous force, should be able to move freely within the bracket. The springier the alignment arch wire, the more important to maintain symmetric arch form. It is better to tip crowns to position during initial alignment rather than displacing the root abscess. This is why round arch wire are preferred for alignment over rectangular one, because rectangular arch wires are tightly fitted within the bracket slot so that the position of the root apex could be affected. Alignment of symmetric crowding. Arch wire choice. Super elastic knot tie is ideal for initial alignment when degree of crowding is similar on two sides of arch. Initial alignment can be accomplished by tying 20 or 40 inch knot tie arch wire that lever about 50 gram into brackets of all teeth. The size of super elastic wire is not a critical variable if it delivers the desired 50 gram force. Opening space for teeth that are crowded out of the arch by two ways. First way, use a crimped stop on the wire just in front of the molar tube so that the arch wire is advanced from the crowded incisor. Second way, use coil springs to open space. If this is done, the springs must deliver only light force to prevent distortion of arch form. This is undesirable method because it may distort the arch form. The initial alignment super elastic arch wires have a tendency to travel around the arch as the patient chews, especially if function is mostly on one side. This can be prevented by crimping a stop tightly onto the arch wire between any two brackets that are reasonably close together or by cinching the end of the wire. Alignment in premolar extraction situation. In patients with severe crowding of anterior teeth, it is necessary to retract the canine into premolar extraction site to gain enough space to align the incisor. This can be done either with segmental retraction loop or sliding the canine along a rigid wire that doesn't contact the incisor. If maximum anchorage is needed, this can be done with skeletal anchorage from bony screw in the alveolus, either direct or indirect. The first picture shows direct anchorage. Second picture show indirect anchorage. In less extreme but still severe crowding, it is possible to tip the canine distally and align the incisor. This can be obtained with knot-tie arch wire coupled with knot-tie coil spring from the first molar to tip the canine distally. The arch wire must be on the both performed by the manufacturer to have an exaggerated reverse curve of SB in order to limit forward tipping of molar. This provides a way to bet distal tipping of canine against forward bodily movement of alignment in non-extraction case. It requires increasing arch length by moving the incisor further from the molar and increasing arch width by using wide arch. How can we increase arch length? By two techniques. First, crimp stop on wire at molar tube so that it holds the wire in front of incisor. Second, bypass the bracket on teeth that are crowded lingually and place coil spring over knot-tie arch wire to generate space. Asymmetric crowding appears when all or nearly all the crowding is in one place. The problem is that if super elastic wire tied into an asymmetrically malaligned arch, teeth distant to the site of malalignment will be moved. An example of asymmetric malalignment is impacted canine. Another example is blocked out lateral incisor as seen in second picture. What is the solution? This problem is solved by adding a small diameter super elastic wire as an auxiliary spring, while the stiff main arch wire was tied into all teeth except the displaced one or two teeth. A segment of super elastic knot-tie can be laid in the bracket on top of the main arch wire or even tied below the bracket of the anchor teeth and tied into the bracket of displaced tooth. The advantage of using this mechanics is control of the tendency to distort arch form and light force against the tooth to be moved. Now we will talk about correction of crossbite. It is important to correct posterior crossbite and mild anterior crossbite in first stage of treatment. Individual teeth displaced into anterior crossbite may be due to lack of space. Correction: first, opening enough space for displaced teeth. Then, it is necessary to use a wide plate to separate the posterior teeth and create the vertical space needed to allow the teeth to move. What about posterior crossbite? Transfer the maxillary expansion by opening the mid-palatal suture. It is easy to widen maxilla by opening mid-palatal suture before and during adolescence, but this becomes more difficult as patients become older. Extraction consideration and time. Patients who are candidate for opening mid-palatal suture may have such a severe crowding that even with this arch expansion, premolar extraction will be required. In this patient, however, separation of suture should be the first step in treatment before either extraction or alignment, because the first premolar teeth are useful as anchorage for lateral expansion and can serve for that purpose even if they are to be extracted later, and the additional space provided by lateral expansion facilitate alignment. Note that sometimes transverse maxillary expansion can provide enough additional space to make extraction unnecessary. The mid-palatal suture should be used primarily as a means of correcting skeletal crossbite, making a narrow maxilla normal, not a normal maxilla abnormally wide. Bonded expander. In mixed dentition, it is easier to place and more retentive than a banded one and may be selected for that purpose. In permanent dentition, a bonded expander is for expansion in case of excessive facial height. A bonded expander of necessity covers a closed surface of posterior teeth, creating a bite plate effect, and this reduces potential for downward backward rotation of mandible during expansion. Correction of dental posterior crossbite by three approaches. 1. A heavy labial expansion arch. 2. Expansion lingual arch. 3. Cross elastic. A heavy labial expansion. The inner bow of a face bow is also, of course, a heavy labial arch, and expansion of this inner bow is a convenient way to expand the upper molar in a patient who is wearing headgear. This expansion is needed for patients with a class 2 molar relationship whose upper arch usually is too narrow to accommodate the mandibular arch, and when it comes forward to correct relationship because the upper molar are tipped lingually. The inner bow is adjusted at each appointment to be sure that it is slightly wider than the headgear tube and must be compressed by the patient when inserting the face bow. If the distal force of a headgear is not desired, a heavy labial auxiliary can provide the expansion effect alone. The effect of the round wire in the headgear tube, however, is to tip the crowns outward And so this method should be reversed for patient whose molar are tipped lingually. This picture show a heavy label arch wire placed in headgear tubes. The first molar can be used for a small amount of expansion and to maintain arch width after palatal suture opening while the teeth are being aligned. Second method, an expansion lingual arch such as W arch or quad helix appliance. Quad helix appliance may be soldered to molar tube or may enter a cleat or attachment on lingual surface of molar tube. Third method, cross elastics. Cross elastics run from lingual of upper molar to buccal of lower molar. Its side effect, it makes extrusion to molar. Adolescent patient can tolerate a short period of cross elastics wear to correct a simple cross bite because any extrusion is compensated by vertical growth of ramus. But in adults, there is a tendency to rotate the mandible forward. Impacted or unerupted teeth. Bringing an impacted or unerupted teeth into arch creates a set of special problems during alignment. The most frequent impaction is a maxillary canine or canines. The problem in dealing with unerupted tooth fall into three categories: surgical exposure, attachment to the tooth, orthodontic mechanics to bring the tooth into the arch. Surgical exposure. It is important for a tooth to erupt through the attached gingiva, not through the alveolar mucosa. If the canine is labially positioned and the probing shows that the crown is not covered with attached tissue, the crown can be exposed with a laser. If the unerupted tooth is more apically positioned in the mandibular arch or on labial side of maxillary alveolar process, a flap should be reflected from crest of alveolus and sutured so that attached gingiva has been transferred to the region where the crown is exposed. Method of attachment. Before availability of direct bonding, a pin was sometimes placed in a hole prepared in the crown of an erupted tooth, but this method is not used now. The least desirable way to obtain attachment is for surgeon to place a wire ligature around the crown of impacted tooth. This results in loss of periodontal attachment because bond is void when the wire is passed around the tooth doesn't regenerate when it is removed and increase the chance of ankylosis. The best approach is simply to expose an area on the crown of tooth, directly bond an attachment to the surface. A button or hook is better than a standard bracket because it is smaller. Then a piece of fine gold chain is tied to attachment, and before the flap is repositioned and sutured into place, this is positioned so that it extends into the mouth. Mechanical approach for aligning unerupted teeth. Ideally, a fixed orthodontic appliance should already be in place before unerupted tooth is exposed to align the other teeth, so that a heavy stabilizing arch wire can be in position at the time of surgery and to create enough space if it doesn't exist, so that orthodontic force can be applied immediately. How to bring unerupted tooth to its position in the arch. An auxiliary nitide wire overlaid on a stabilizing arch in the same way is the most efficient way to bring impacted tooth into position. Other attachment methods are special alignment spring, either soldered to a heavy base arch wire or bent into a light arch wire, or a cantilever spring from the auxiliary tube on the first molar can be used. Finally, magnetic force. Ankylosis of an erupted tooth. It is a potential problem if an area of fusion to the adjacent bone develop, orthodontic movement of an erupted tooth become impossible. It can sometimes be free to continue movement by luxating the tooth. If this procedure is done, it is critically important to apply orthodontic force immediately after the luxation, since it is only a matter of time until the tooth re-ankyloses. Unerupted impacted lower second molar. Impaction of lower second molar usually develops during orthodontic treatment. This occurs when medial marginal ridge of second molar catch against distal surface of first molar or the edge of first molar bend so that the second molar progressively taps medially instead of moving first molar posteriorly during mixed dentition increases the chance that second molar will become impacted. Correction of impacted second molar requires tipping of tooth posteriorly and uprighting it. If medial margin ridge can be unlocked, the tooth will erupt on its own. And when second molar is not severely tipped, the simplest solution is to place a separator like brass wire between. The easiest way to do this is to use a segment of nitide wire from auxiliary tube on first molar. Two tube on second molar. Rectangular wire is preferred. This provides a lighter force to align the second molar while a heavier and more rigid wire remain in place anteriorly. Diastema closure. A maxillary midline diastema is often complicated by insertion of labial frenum into a notch in alveolar bone, so that a band of heavy fibrous tissue lie between the central incisor. The frenectomy must be carried out in a way that will produce a good aesthetic result and must be properly coordinated with orthodontic treatment. It is an error to surgically remove the frenum at an early age and then delay orthodontic treatment in the hope that the diastema will close spontaneously. If the frenum is removed while there is still a space between central incisor, scar tissue forms between teeth as healing progresses. It is better to align the teeth before frenectomy and sliding them together along and if the diastema is small, it is possible to bring the central incisor completely together before surgery. If the space is large and frenal attachment is thick, it may not be possible to completely close the space before surgical intervention. The space should be closed at least partially, and the orthodontic movement to bring the teeth together should be resumed immediately after the frenectomy so that the teeth are brought. Healing occurs with the teeth together and the post-surgical scar tissue stabilizes the teeth instead of creating obstacle to final closure of the space. Finally, bonded fixed retainer is recommended.